White is I here, and I'm here doing my first podcast, actually. I was going to do a commentary, but I'm a little tired, so I figured, you know what? I've been wanting to do a podcast, just talk like 15, 20 minutes, you know, talk about random shit. And, you know, the first topic will be movies. But these are physical media movies that I buy at our local, like, media shop. It's called Paradise Mike's. Yeah, it's a guy, he's got old comic books, vinyls, CDs, tapes, all the old shit that we all grew up with. Well, the ones who are old enough, at least. No young person's listening to this. Well, anyway, I go over there and I get DVDs to movies that I just find, like, oh, no, I want this. I want a physical copy of this so I can never not have it, so if I want to watch it. They do have Blu-rays there, but they have a lot of DVDs and some VHS. It's, well, really small amount of VHS, but DVDs mainly. And I usually go and get ones that, you know, I just can't find, or sometimes I find some gems in there, actually. And an example of a gem would be finding the fucking Pumpkinhead 2 on DVD, and it was part of a 4-pack, actually. I got it right here. One second. Yeah, this came from Lionsgate. It's a 4-pack DVD. It was Pumpkinhead 2, Blood Wings. That's an incredibly hard movie to find right now, so I was really happy I found that. And they do have a Blu-ray version of it. I believe Shout Factory did it, or Scream Factory, I should say. But I don't think you can get it now, or if you have, you probably have to spend a shitload of money, and I just can't. Unless it's a movie that I really, really love and you really cannot find it, I just can't spend that much money on it. You know, it's like, I think it's up in the $100 range, and like, I could get like 20 great Werner Herzog films and documentaries in this pack for $100, so it's like, I'd rather get that. But anyway, let me tell the other movies are Leprechaun, Warwick Davis, you know, classic, Jennifer Aniston, and also Wishmaster 1 and 2 came with this pack. So, you know, I think this is a damn good buy for $1. So, yeah, most of their DVDs are $1, unless they're a special one. They do know. I did get the original taking of Pelham 123, the one with Robert Shaw, not the new one with Travolta and Denzel. Robert Shaw and, what's his name, Walter Matthau. Really good movie. It's an awesome movie, but I had to pay like $8 for that one, but worth it because it's an awesome film. Well, anyway, that was my first, like, gem I got, but yesterday I did get some movies, and I'm just going to go tell you what movies I got and why I got them. All right, first one we're going to have is Better Off Dead, starring John Cusack, a 1980s comedy. I do have a lot of comedies. I don't buy comedies on Blu-ray just because I don't feel you need to have a comedy on Blu-ray. I do have, like, the best of Mel Brooks. Well, not the best of. It's Mel Brooks from, like, the 70s to the early 90s. All his movies from that time on Blu-ray. It was gifted to me, so I didn't buy it. But I just don't feel, if you like comedies, just get it on DVD. You're fine. And, like, if you can, you'll get it for a lot cheaper, too. And it will still work, because a comedy, I don't think visually needs to look fantastic, you know? It's just, it's got to make you laugh. It doesn't have to intrigue you with, and I'm saying I do have Fear and Loathing in Las Vegas on Blu-ray, so there's one thing, but that's, you know, a director that is known for visuals. But anyway, let's get on with why I got the movie. I think it's one of the more underrated, oddball, like, comedies of that time, from the 80s. I like the character a lot. John Cusack is a guy who pretty much just lost his mojo, you know what I mean? Like, he was going out with the best-looking girl in school. He had a cool Camaro and everything, and then his Camaro breaks down. His girlfriend is attracting another guy, and he just goes into a funk. And there's this girl from Paris who's, like, actually, the actress in it and the character is really good.
Hello? Hello?
Ah, bonjour.
And also, fucking Booger from... God, I'm going to say his name. I'm not going to call him Booger. Oh, fuck. How is he not listed in here? Well, anyway, Booger from from Revenge of the Nerds is in there as well, and he's fucking hilarious. He's got a lot of crazy shit, and it's very imaginative, too. Like, there's a whole clay animation music video segment in the movie, and also it's just off. Like, I don't know, it's got a John Hughes feel, but I'm pretty sure it's not John Hughes. It's like a John, it's like a discount John Hughes. Somebody trying to do a John Hughes movie, but it's just like a little bit more, it's not as good as a John Hughes 16 Candles or fucking Breakfast Club, but I still think it's awesome, and I always find it funny. One of my favorite things is when he's in his car and these two like Asian guys that he goes to school with come up to him, and one can't speak English, he drives the car, and the other one does speak English, but he learned from fucking Howard Cosell.
It's an awesome spectacle. An audacious display of seething opponents. Once again, parallel. In an obstinate attempt to prove superiority of the roads, unequal in our lifetime.
But it's really funny. And I just got it because I love it. Well, it's just, like I said, keep it short and sweet. Next one, another comedy. And this one was actually still wrapped up in its packaging, so I was happy about that. And this one is 1997's Private Parts. Howard Stern was a huge deal growing up. I know people don't remember this, but yeah, he was still the guy until like 2008, 2010 is really when podcasting came out and radio started taking that nosedive. But he was still the man. And this movie, I fucking loved this movie as a kid. It was really, I thought it was fucking hysterical. And I found it entertaining. I like the autobiography part of it. Just knowing, seeing like how he came as a kid to wanting to be a DJ. And he could barely talk. Like, and how he came up with his wild ideas. And how he just said, fuck it, I'm going to do what I want. And it got him to the top of radio. And I'm not going to lie, when I was a kid, I loved the nudity in this movie. I loved the fact that there was a bunch of naked women in it. And like, there's a few scenes where they're naked for a while, so I was just like, this is fucking great. And one thing about it is, I do remember, Jesus, I'm sorry, you're going to hear a little bit of my real talking here, which is, I'm sure if you're the commentator, it's like, yeah, we know, you stutter and mumble and shit. I'm trying to work on that. But anyway, I did rewatch it a few years ago, and I didn't find it as funny until Paul Giamatti came in the fucking movie. And that's what Howard needs in this movie, is he needs somebody working against him. Like, that's the exact opposite. And you don't get that until Paul Giamatti comes in. And that's like maybe a little bit past the halfway mark of the film. Probably actually like the last quarter of the film, actually. But dude, those scenes are fucking hysterical. They still hold up today. Actually, when I got it, I did put it on just to watch those scenes. So this movie suffers because it's not enough Paul Giamatti. And I can see why they want it to be, you know, his actual rise. Like the shit you didn't really hear, or maybe you did hear about as a fan back then. And it's dude, but Paul Giamatti and Howard Stern, like, when they're on the screen together, they're so fucking funny, dude. Howard's doing the most fucked up shit to this guy, but this guy won't let him fucking pig vomit. Yeah, Kenny. Kenny pig vomit. I call him pig vomit because he looks like a pig and he makes me want to vomit, hence pig vomit. But anyway, it's just so goddamn funny how he just fucks with this dude and he just takes his bits to the air and just really reams them and fucking gets the ratings, so the guy can't do anything. He's just like, fuck. And at the end of the very end of the movie, they show like, and that's another thing I do like about this movie is the mockumentary aspect of it. They have a few scenes in there that feel like, oh, this feels real. Like, oh, they went out with these naked girls and tried to do shit naked in public, like saying Howard goes to Philadelphia, or I don't exactly remember. Everywhere Howard goes to New York. And, like, it feels a little more real. But at the end of the movie, they have Stuttering John come in. I think his part was real. He's like, oh, yeah, it was probably just, like, a two-second thing. Like, oh, let's fucking film something real fast with him. Saying, like, how he's pissed that he's not in the movie. Even though he's in the movie, he's just in those little small mockumentary scenes. But yeah, at the very end, Paul Giamatti playing Kenny is out there. He's like, "Yeah, I'm doing pretty good. I'm no longer in radio. I'm I got the fourth biggest mall in Alabama, so I'm doing pretty good. That ain't no nothing to sneeze at." But he's like, "Yeah, Howard Stern. If it wasn't for Howard Stern, we'd be still doing radio in New York City. Howard fucking Stern. Like, it's so goddamn funny.
I'll tell you, Howard Stern, man. That motherfucker.
It is good shit. So I got it, and like I said, it was wrapped, so I'm like, fuck, I can't not get it. Like, it's a new fucking DVD. It hasn't been open. Probably from like 2001, 2002. Next movie. It's, Troll 1 and 2. Now, if you don't know why I got this, then obviously you haven't seen Troll 2. Maybe you've seen Troll 1. Troll 1's not that great of a movie. Fucking Troll 2 was not a great movie either. Not even that good. It's actually known for being one of the best worst movies ever. There's even a documentary made by the guy who starred in the movie, the kid, called Best Worst Movie Ever. And it's got a few scenes in it. I don't know. This family goes to a new town, and it's called Nilbog, which is goblin backwards, even though it's Troll 2, but they're going with goblins. So it should have been called Goblin, really, but whatever. Maybe there was a rights issue, and they're like, fuck it. Let's just take this movie and we'll call it Troll 2. Jesus Christ. We'll call it Troll 2. Troll 2. Oh, shit. That means, 1 second. That's better. That is better. You know what? Let's just take a moment to breathe and relax. Get a little zen here. Ready? Let's start with 10 seconds, starting now. Just relax. All things good. Sorry. All right, anyway. Sorry. And I just got this because I was like, it's a shitty movie, but god damn it. Do I love that scene when that kid's turning into a tree? Yeah, kid turns into a tree so he can be eaten by the goblins because they eat trees. I don't know. Yeah, whatever. And this guy's seeing another person that was turned into a tree being eaten, and he's just goes,
"They're eating her! And then they're going to eat me! Oh my god!"
It's so goddamn... Oh, it's so funny, man. And I remember actually seeing this movie as a kid, and it did scare the shit out of me, actually. And I was a really little kid. I'm talking like 5, 6, 7, so gotta give me a break here. All right, well, next was a nice little surprise. It's one of the thin little DVD cases that you would see, so you're like, oh, okay, it's one of those DVDs, or like kind of like those shitty, like, direct-to-VHS or, like, DVD kind of movies that really low budget. But when I saw it, I was happy to see Mad Dog Morgan starring Dennis Hopper. And this is a fucking awesome little movie. I was a little disappointed because I found I had the edited version where they took out nudity and some language and some violence, which I was like, ah, that sucks. So it must be like some like Australian. I think they did that shit in like Australia, Asia. They had like cuts of the movie like that. He's kind of a Robin Hood character, and he was kind of a lovable outlaw. Like, people liked Mad Dog Morgan because he was just like a fun dude. He would like drink and get drunk, and he would rob you, and then, you know, he'd like, let's have some drinks together, and then he'd just be like, you know, I'm sorry I robbed you, here's your money, like, after he bought some drinks with it. And there's like, oh, okay, at least I was kind of forced to buy this guy drinks, basically. So, you know, it's that, but it ends up being a big manhunt, and it's an awesome movie. I say, if you haven't seen it, it is on YouTube. There's the edited version, and then there is a better quality unrated version. Watch the unrated version. Don't get excited about the nudity, because the only nudity you're going to see is fucking Dennis Hopper's ass. That's it. And that's before he gets raped in the movie. So it's like, oh shit. Like, but anyway, awesome movie. If you like Westerns, you'll dig that. It's definitely a Western, just set in Australia.
We came to have our photograph taken. Well, I just want to keep my head, Mr. Morgan. Would you like a drink?
Oh, would I like a drink? Yes.
Oh, now here in the next movie was a risk. I still haven't even looked at it. It is called Melody. And it's a movie I've never seen before, but the cover was interesting. And the description was interesting. And I'm not 100% sure if I can play this movie, because I did notice when I bought it that there was a Region 3 on here, so I'm not sure if I can play this. Maybe I can get it to work on the computer and, you know, rip it. But if not, I do plan on getting a region-free Blu-ray DVD player soon so I can get movies like this and watch them. But anyway, this movie is actually about two 10-year-old kids, boy and a girl, who are, like, say they're in love, and they tell their parents, we are going to get married. The story and screenplay is done by Alan Parker. He's a good filmmaker. I can't think of a movie right now other than Mississippi Burning, which is an awesome movie. And he also did Pink Floyd's The Wall.
Melody? Yeah? Shall we get married? Will you love me that long?
Of course. I've loved you a whole week already, haven't I?
Crying face, looking at millions of signs. She knows that life is around.
Kids movies, like, that's pretty interesting. Like, there are, like, times when you're a kid and you think you're in love with somebody and you're just like, oh my god, but that's crazy that they're gonna take it to a level like, no, we're really getting married and we are gonna be married now and you're gonna have to refer to her as my wife and I'm her husband. So it's like, that's pretty crazy. So I bought that just out of straight curiosity for $1. If it doesn't work, it sucks. But like I said, I'll be able to eventually watch it and maybe review that one, you know, if it's good or if it sucks, I'll be like, whatever. Anyway, we're going to go with the last thing I bought. This actually cost me $5. And it's one of the old DVD 50 movie pack collections that used to see, like, at Walmart or any kind of, like, just dollar store or anything like that. And, where you get a bunch of movies for, you know, $2 or $10 or something like that. 50 movies for $10, that's a hell of a deal, you know. And they're usually, like, shit movies or, like, movies that are good, but they have, you know, they're not that great, grainy in the look and maybe not the best sound and everything like that. But this movie has a bunch, I mean, this pack had a bunch of good movies on it, actually. I was really surprised to see Christmas Evil on here, which is a movie I like a lot. And I was actually I watch that every Christmas. I just like the insanity of that movie, even though I don't consider it a horror movie, really. It's more of a character study of somebody who, John Waters actually just described the movie. I'm taking this from Joe Bob Briggs when he did it on his last drive-in. Is John Waters says it's a man in transition to being Santa Claus. So it's like, that's exactly what it is. Like, yeah, actually it is. He's making himself Santa. But yeah, there's that movie, Dead Time Stories, which is like a bunch of, you know, it's one of the anthology movies, you know, from the 80s. That's not amazing, but there's some fun parts in it and lots of good actors, so that's fun to see. Metamorphosis, so I was happy to see that too, because I used to have that on VHS back in the day. And what was so special about that movie was the VHS. The gimmick was a awesome cover where it had, like, if you pressed a button, there was a little, this guy was like, he has, like, in the movie, he's got this crazy, like, head brace on from this injury, and when you hit like his throat, you would hear a little scream and the eyes would light. I remember seeing that as a kid, and I had that, and it worked for like a long ass time, but finally in like 2003, 2004, it finally died out, and I was like, dude, this thing went like 20 fucking years, like, being able to hit that button. But anyway, like, it's Dead Time Stories. See, what else we got? Driller Killer with, that's Abe Ferrell. Driller Killer, sucks. It's not a good movie, but the fact it's they got an Abe Ferrell movie on here, like, why am I calling Ferrell like he's Will Ferrell? Abe Ferrara. He's got a crazy name. But, his two best well-known movies are, King of New York with, Christopher Walken. Fun movie, nice 80s gem, and also one of the most, I would say, grimy, like, gross, like, New York street movies is Bad Lieutenant. And yeah, that's like, so you get to see where he comes from, and the best thing about Driller Killer is the title. I'll give you that. If any movie was to be remade, like, remake Driller Killer, because there's a lot you can deal with that. also, Horror Express with Christopher Lee and fucking all the classic Hammer horror movie stars. So that's awesome, too. Like, that's, you know, so far it's like, yeah, you know, I'm getting some good shit. Deep Red, the Giallo classic. It's like, whoa, how did this fucking get on here? Like, Bad Taste, Peter Jackson. That's a fucking very fun movie to watch. Silent Night, Bloody Night. Not Silent Night, Deadly Night. Silent Night, Bloody Night. Not as good as Silent Identity, but still fun. It's like I said, I'm just at, Kathy's Curse. I know about Kathy's Curse from Red Letter Media. I'm a huge Red Letter Media fan, so I'm excited to be able to take those clips of her, calling this little cute girl calling a woman a fat whore.
Fat whore!
Fat whore!
Track of the Moonbeast, a Mystery Science Theater classic that I'm happy to have. What's in the chili?
Oh, a lot of things. Chicken, corn, green peppers, chili, onions.
Oh, Jesse James Meets Frankenstein's Daughter, a classic 60s Italian goofy horror movie. It's fun as fuck to watch, though. A Bucket of Blood. Like, I mean, so far, like, this is a lot of fucking fun shit. Like, I Bury the Living? God damn, this is fun shit. And last but not least, Drive-In Massacre, which is a movie that I think should be remade. It's, I'm sure, the low-quality version of it. I have seen a better quality version that was on YouTube for a while, but for some reason I can't find it, and I'm like, why can't I find this? Like, what? You know, whatever. But I like the idea of a killer at the drive-in. Of course, that's fucking awesome. And that was that. Yeah. Oh yeah, it was called Chilling Classics 12 DVD collection. And yeah, well shit, it's already been a half an hour. I was thinking just 15 minutes, you know, but I don't know, I kind of feel like still like talking. So okay, I fucked up the drum. You know what? Story time, ladies and gentlemen. Story time. I was going to do this as a video, but you know what? I think this is a better story to tell. And I want to start telling some more stories about my past and my love of movies and my love of music and comedy and stuff like that. Movies, by far, though, are... It's kind of... Movies kind of have everything that I love in one nice package that I can watch. But anyway. This is a story about why I'm grateful for Pauly Shore. You're like, Pauly Shore? What? Why Pauly Shore? Well, first of all, when I was a kid, I loved Pauly Shore. I mean, but then again, I'm not the only one. There's a bunch, but me and my sister particularly were really big fans. My brother liked him, of course, but he's a little older than us, so after his time of a few years, he was kind of like, fucking Pauly Shore. And we were like, me and my sister were like, what? Oh, he's funny. Like, no, he's not. Like, we were like, all right, whatever. I'm sure, you know, of course, everybody's come around to loving Pauly Shore again. But anyway, yeah, I was a really big fan of Son-in-Law. I love Son-in-Law. I thought it was funny. And it's just the squeeze the juice. Looks like there's a bunch of trouble. Shit like that. You know, of course, Encino Man. It all started with Encino Man, really. Of course, that was the first movie. And, you know, he kind of steals the show in Encino Man. Even though Brendan Fraser does a good job, Sean Austin, unfortunately, gets fucking blown out of the water. Like, from those two. Like, those two are, like, they're on the next level, kind of, in that movie. But anyway, squeeze the juice! Okay, no, sorry. And then Son-in-Law came out. And then Son-in-Law kind of solidified, because not only that, my parents were big country music fans. They still are. But back then, they were younger. They would go out in bars and stuff like that, go dancing. And they just loved that, the whole idea of this fucking city slicker, like, going to a farm and getting his ass handed to him, and then him kind of rising to the occasion. But, he was also had a little bit part in the Goofy movie, where he pretty much is himself in Goofy form, you know, so that was funny. Yeah, the Leaning Tower of Cheesa. They probably had to pay him a shitload of money just to be in that movie for like 5 minutes. Well, anyway, let's get down to it. The story starts with me and my sister finding out there's a new Pauly Shore movie, and it's called Jury Duty. And we were so excited to go see it, and I remember, I don't know what happened. For some reason, my mom and sister, my mom and brother were, I think in Santa Barbara or somewhere else, and it just left me and my dad and my sister at the house, and my dad came up with his suggestion, hey, let's go to the movies, let's watch Jury Duty. And me and my sister were like, fuck yes, let's do this, let's fucking do this. And we went and watched the movie, we were all excited, and we liked it, of course. Like, there was, like, being kids, you find these goofy moments that you like, and, I can't, like, one of the favorite things that me and my sister like was Pauly Shore has to, like, he's in jury duty, and the hotel he's at, he's got to stay with one of the other jurors who listens to this motivational, like, tape he listens to. And one of the weird things is, like, this guy's like, I can accomplish my goals. Me and my sister, for some reason, that was, like, some of the funniest shit. I am good. And I can do better than what I thought I can. Like, stuff like that. But anyway, we were like, oh, it's funny. I can tell. Thinking about it now, I remember my dad was not, like, laughing as much. And that movie, yeah, does not hold up. It's not that funny. There's only a few things in it that I consider funny. And this was, like I said, at the drive-in. And there was another movie at the drive-in that my dad didn't know anything about. I didn't know anything about. Of course, my sister didn't know anything about, because she was even younger. And my dad was like, do you want to stay for the other movie? And I remember thinking, like, now we saw the Pauly Shore. I don't even know what this movie is. And we're like, you know what? Let's stay. And I was like, what is it? Like, another funny movie? He's like, yeah, it's another comedy. And that movie was Tommy Boy. And needless to say, Tommy Boy blew fucking Jury Duty out of the water. We were laughing harder in the first 5 minutes of Tommy Boy than the whole fucking movie of Jury Duty. And this brought a love of Chris Farley to me and my sister, too. Me and my sister love Farley. My dad loves Farley, too. My whole family loves Farley. My brother and my mother love Farley, too. I mean, who doesn't love Farley? But me and my sister were just like, this motherfucker. Like, this fucking guy. It's hysterical, like, and I just, like, fell in love with Farley. I still love Farley. I remember in, like, back in the day when me and my sister were in Santa Barbara at my grandparents' house, and we were watching TV, and then the news came on, and I don't know why we had on the news, but and one of the first stories was, oh, actor Chris Farley dies, and me and my sister were actually, like, no, fuck, you're kidding me. Like, no, like, we must have been only about, like, 11, I must have been, like, 11, 12, maybe, 12, 13, no, I must be, like, 11, 12 years old. My sister's probably, like, 8, 9, And we were just like so sad that he died. And he just left an impact. All his movies were so fucking... I mean, even if they weren't funny, he was funny in it. He was always on fucking point. Me and my sister went to go see fucking Beverly Hills Ninja. Remember that? Beverly Hills Ninja doesn't hold up, but I still fucking... I have that movie, and I think it's still funny. Funnier than people give it credit, don't give it credit for. Like, oh, it's not funny. It's like, no, there's funny shit in it. It's just not as funny as Tommy Boy. Or, yeah, like, I wouldn't say it's even as funny as Black Sheep. Black Sheep is funny, too. There's a lot of good shit in it. That was actually when I rewatched that a few years ago. I was like, this is funnier than I remember, actually. And there was Almost Heroes as well. One of my favorite things that Farley ever did, though, was his little cameo performance in fucking... Well, his cameos, actually. I'll get to my favorite cameo performance, but let's talk about his cameo performances. I believe he was in Coneheads, of course, as the boyfriend. He's not that funny in it. He's just kind of there. Like, I guess, like, since she's odd, like, it's, oh, she's attracted to the fat guy. Like, oh, like, creative, guys. Well, anyway, like, he's not that funny in it, but he is fucking funny in Wayne's World 1 and Wayne's World 2. when fucking Wayne asks, like, Where's Mr. Big going on tour? And he's like, he's gonna go come to Chicago, then to Wisconsin, to Milwaukee. No, he'll Milwaukee, then to Chicago, back to Chicago, back to Wisconsin. He's fucking like, he's so goddamn funny in that movie. Like, and he's only in it for like literally like 2 minutes, and he just steals the scenes. The second one, he's in it for a lot longer. He's funny. He's playing, like, a Rodian training. And, like, it's funny how fucking they're doing a roadie test where a microphone cord falls and all these guys have to go out on the stage and put it back up while fucking Wayne's shooting fucking tennis balls at him. And then when Farley goes up, they're just fucking rocketing those balls at him. And he's just like, And they do the fucking, why don't you just quit? Because I've got no place else to go. They do a Richard Gere fucking reference. Anyway, I think there's another one. It's not coming to me. Because I want to get to my favorite thing. Maybe my favorite thing Farley's ever done on film. Which is his character from fucking... oh my god, Dirty Work. Which is, you know, Jimmy. Which is... He was perfect. He was made for that. Jimmy should have had... If fucking Farley didn't die, we could have had a Jimmy movie, and that would have been fucking hilarious. And there's the Saigon whore that bit my nose off! Oh, fucking A. Or, dude, even better. Looks like there's gonna be a fight. Is he gonna play something good?
Hell yeah! Rolling Stones, Street Fighting Man, G7!
You just hit G8. If
you
like pina
coladas. You know what? I think I'm going to wrap this up now. If you guys like this, please give it a thumbs up. I hate to be one of those guys that begs and shit. Like, I guess I should ask for this at the beginning, because I don't think all you guys are going to hang in for this. But anyway, thumbs up, you know, comment if you want to. Maybe, like, hey, maybe talk about this subject or that subject. Or just say, I don't want you doing this. Go back to commentaries. Or, you know what? I don't like you. Go fucking throw yourself off a bridge. Which I won't do that, but you can still tell me to, you can still ask me to do it, but I won't do it. You know, whatever. I'm gonna get going and probably watch one of these movies. Maybe see if this Melody movie will play or not. I'm not sure. Probably not, but I'm gonna give it a shot. If not, I'm gonna watch fucking Better Off Dead. Alright, well, this is Why It Is I saying thanks for sticking around and listening to my first podcast. Alright, well, you have yourselves a good night. Or, you know what? Don't have a good night. Have a great night. All right. Anyway, you guys take it easy.